brings light. I pray that there shall be light in every dark situation in our life this morning, for the glory and honor of your dear name. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. I say in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Come on, lift up your hands above your head.
Says, for though we walk in the flesh,
we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, as all, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. It's interesting when studying this scripture that what Paul is speaking to the Ephesian church about spiritual warfare, you notice that it is very different to our understanding about what spiritual warfare is, because any time you mention the word spiritual warfare for a Christian, automatically it switches to prayer, because the Christian thinks that we are talking about prayer. But in speaking about the spiritual armor, first of all, Paul is telling the Ephesian church, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his mind, meaning that your strength is found in the Lord. Your strength is not finding yourself, or your education, or your experience. Your strength is not finding anything physical, but your strength is found in the Lord. In other words, Paul is telling them, you can only be as strong when you are in the Lord. No wonder Jesus says that if you abide in me and my words abide in you. It means you must have a connection with God. Anytime a Christian is away from the Lord, or communication with the Lord, is like fish that is out of water. You cannot survive. The breath of God, I think it's Pastor Alice was sharing with us yesterday, that the breath or the presence of the Lord is life to me. Because the presence of the Lord is life to a Christian. Without God's presence, a Christian is lifeless. A Christian might be very active in the things of God or in the ministry, but without God's presence, a Christian is lifeless. So you can only be strong in the Lord and in the power of his mind. Put on the full armor of God, because this armoring, as we are going to see, comes together. If you don't have one part of it, the rest of the armor is going to fall out of place. That you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. What the scripture is talking about, the wiles and the tactics of the enemy. It's like persuading or seducing you out of the truth. The devil does not have real power. What he does is that he persuades you. He uses tactics. You can see that by when the devil was tempting Eve, for instance. He was using tactics. Said, did the Lord not say this? He was just playing mind games with Eve. For we wrestle not, and this is important. I think Bishop has taught us that we don't wrestle. Your boss is not the problem. Your spouse is not the problem. The people that you see is not the problem. There is a power behind the people you see. And scripture teaches us that the invisible things are more real than the visible. And the invisible things are more permanent than the visible. So the things that we see, the enemy that you think you have is not the enemy actually. The enemy has masqueraded as someone you know. That is why when the devil wants even to visit you, for instance, he'll use an image of a dead person, isn't it? Then you think that I've talked to my mother in my dream. But you know you can't talk to the dead, can you? But the enemy picks an image that you know. The image that you know. So he picks the mother that you love so much. You see, by the way, my mother loves me so much. We have fellowship in our dreams. Like yesterday night, we talked for 2 hours. No, you are not talking to her. She's there. Because scripture tells us, wherever you go in the grave, there is no life there. So those people cannot come back to us. The flesh and blood is not what we are fighting against. We are fighting principalities and powers and rulers and darkness of this world against spiritual wickedness in this high places. Wherefore, take on the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand the evil day, and having done all to stand. Now, what is the evil day? You and I live in this age and know that evil day to us is like every day, isn't it? We are living in the evil of days. In fact, in your very house, there is evil. It is very hard to find righteousness, but evil is seen everywhere. Now, because I was not talking about that, I want to talk about the spiritual armor. And the first one I want to talk about is from the Ephesians verse 14, 6 verse 14. It says, "Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth." With truth. It is, remember, Paul is using the analogy of a Roman soldier because of the understanding of the people that he is writing to. He's using the analogy because they knew how the Roman soldier was able to dress. It is fitting that the belt of truth is the first piece of the whole armor of God. Therefore, truth is the utmost importance in the life of a Christian. Without truth, the rest of the armor should be of no use to us because we will not have the spirit of truth. Truth is very important. Remember, in the Roman soldier, the truth was able to hold everything in place. The truth was able to hold the breastplate, was able to hold the sword, was able to hold every armor he had. It means truth was very important. Truth was able to keep everything together. And without truth, no armory is able to stay in place. And come to think about it, Scripture says in John 14, 6, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one cometh to the Father except through me." Meaning that the truth Paul is talking about here is not just an ornament, it's not just a part of an armor. The truth is Christ himself. And it is impossible to live a Christian life without knowing the truth, because the spirit of truth must be upon you. The belt of a Roman soldier in those days was not a simple leather strap such as we wear today. It was a thick, heavy leather metal band with a protective piece hanging down from in front of it. It was a big thing that was holding every armor. What Paul is trying to tell us here, that the spiritual warfare is not just something that you do on your knees or in your prayer closet. The spiritual warfare, or armor we have, is something that you walk around with all the time. It means when you speak the truth, you are fighting. When you speak the truth, you are winning the war. When you go to a tattoo and you've been given more change, and you're telling the conductor, "You've given more change, I need to return the rest," you're winning against the devil. So it's not something that you come and do by the end of the day, no. Because Scripture tells us that we are at war all the time. No wonder Joel 3:10 says that now each one of us, we need to beat our pleasures into swords and our pruning hooks into spears and let the weak be strong, because we are in a spiritual battle. Not only for 7 days, not only for 7 hours in a day, but for 24 hours in a day. The war we are fighting, ladies and gentlemen, is a 24 hours, our engagement is a 7 day a week engagement. It is not something that we do for some seasons. It's not time to say that you are going to be in spiritual warfare for this week. It does not happen. We are at war. Hallelujah. Now, Paul tells Timothy that a soldier does not entangle himself in civilian affairs. We are at war throughout, and we cannot afford to be asleep or insensitive to what the enemy is doing, because the enemy is at your life 24/7. Someone was saying, "I think if you don't want the devil to trouble you, don't trouble him." But the devil doesn't want that way. The devil is against your life because you carry the image of God 24/7. So the enemy is fighting you 24 hours. Spiritual battle or armory is not left for a chosen few. It's not for bishops and apostles and reverends and pastors. Spiritual armory is for all of us. The belt of truth is a crucial piece of defensive armor guarding our inmost being in the battle against the lies and deceptions of the enemy. It is the truth that you have that sets you free. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. So anytime you walk in that office and tell your employer the truth, means you're winning the battle. Hallelujah. Oh, how I pray for the return of truth in the believer's life. Eh? The return of truth, speaking the truth in love, but speaking the truth anyway. Because very few people are ready to take the truth. You will never substitute God's discipline of living a truthful life with prayer. Because some of us think that you can say a lie and then come to prayer. No. All these things are intertwined. The spiritual armory is intertwined. When you live a truthful life, you have more power and energy into prayer. When you live a truthful life, it means you have confidence to approach God's throne. So ladies and gentlemen, the spiritual warfare is not what you do when you come on Sunday. The spiritual warfare is what you do from Monday to Friday at your workplace. When you're making those requisitions, and when you're writing those checks, and when you're filling those forms, are you saying the truth? Because truth is one of the armors of the Christian. Ephesians 4:14 says that we have formed no more children, tossed to and fro, and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the slave of men, and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. But speaking the truth in love, may grow up in him in all things which is the head, even Christ. That we are no longer tossed to and fro, but we understand the truth. And how I pray that that truth may come back to the church, that you are not tossed. It is amazing how Christians today are tossed to and fro by the wind of doctrine. It's about the newest preacher in town. It's about the newest revelation you have. It's about the newest book you're reading. It's about the newest truth. But you see, I've noticed that God does not require you to know much revelation. He just wants you to practice the revelation you know. Because we become information junkies or revelation junkies. We have so much revelation that you listen very little of it. We are practicing very little of it. You get somebody who is well blessed in a matatu, and then somebody is calling, "Where are you?" "Oh, Nakuona, Nikotown, Tayari." You are miles away from town. And then you look at him, you think that he's going to be ashamed of saying, "The guy is so lame, that's too bad." No. Just ask him, "Where were we?" "We got to Nongera again." Because it's just like wiping your mouth and continuing, as if nothing has happened. You know, have you ever seen people? Today we are living in those perilous times that Apostle Paul was telling Timothy about, that people are not disturbed, their conscience is there. In fact, Paul was saying, their conscience has been saved the whole time. Somebody can look straight in the face and then you can lie. I love you. You are a blessing. And you know that is not true. Yeah? All the week he has been telling people how you are a terrible guy. But when he calls you, when he meets you, who's this Christian? Christian says, "Oh, praise the Lord, sister. Yeah, you're a blessing to the church. Blessing to the church." Now, number two, breastplate of righteousness. It says, number 14, verse 14 says, continues to say, "Not be, and having on the breastplate of righteousness." Matthew 6:33 says, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things shall be added." See, God says, "Take care of my business, I'll take care of yours. Seek after me, all these things are in me." Because Christ is the revealed fullness of the Godhead, isn't it? According to his divine nature, Scripture says, has given us all things pertaining to life and godliness. So if we seek Christ, then we have sought everything. If we know Christ, we have known everything. The breastplate of righteousness. This is what guards our hearts and every vital organ that we have as Christians is righteousness. Right standing with God. That we stand right in God. Psalm 23 says, "He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. I shall walk in the paths of righteousness." I wonder if we call for a conference on righteousness, how many people would attend? I know people would attend if it is financial prosperity. 14, conference on understanding the 24 altars affecting Kenya. Maybe that one will attend. I wonder how many people would just say, this is a conference on righteousness and holiness. How many people would attend? Because people have replaced the discipline in living a righteous life with activity. But you think by performance, you are acceptable to God. No. Saul understood that very well from God. He says, obedience is better than obeying God's word and living in accordance to his word is better than anything else you can do for him. Your position in church or your activity in church does not replace your conduct to God. Jesus says, many shall come to me and say, Lord, we did so many things in your name, but he says, no, I do not know you. Because how many people does God know? He knows people who are righteous. He says his eyes are moved to and fro, looking for the righteous people. Today we have people full of talent, but low on character. The reason, the mere fact that you see a preacher chasing out demons does not mean he's trained, isn't it? You need to live with him to find out his testimony. Because testimony is built over time, isn't it? And I usually tell parents with teenagers, before you give your daughter to that man of God because you've heard him preach a powerful message, or maybe he has come here for one day, please try to inquire, isn't it? Try to ask around. Try to ask your church pastors around here, how well do you know so and so? Because we have a lot of so-called mentorships happening nowadays. And I keep telling people, by the way, a pastor can preach to your daughter, can maybe teach, but mentorship is deeper than that, isn't it? You cannot say, I am mentoring girls. It's not possible. There are things I cannot teach them. Unless we go out of the scriptures, isn't it? I can teach them, I can guide them, but I can't mentor them. It's not possible. That we have this office now, we are mentoring. And those, by the way, and I keep on telling people, anytime you go to a preacher and you want to follow him, ask them, where is your father? Because so many people don't have fathers. And there are priestess preachers in town. Powerful people. Oh, I want power. They're powerful. No doubt about it. But they preach revelation. But character, they don't have character. So seek to find out. Because not only preachers, even leaders in church, you know, if you have substituted what we call the holy Christian living with activity. You are, because when the food bench, I remember the white pastor was telling me in a church why he doesn't have people sit in front here. Because they used to sit there. Then an elder does something wrong. You don't know how to bring him back. He's here. Correct? Maybe that's why we are all sitting here. So that whatever you do, you just remain there. But you know, today you have Christian leaders who the fear of God is gone. I mean, somebody can do a shitty business on Saturday, and Sunday just come in the front of the people. You hear somebody has disappeared with somebody's girl, but on Sunday, he's just here. The fear of God is. But remember, righteousness is an armor. So you cannot replace the righteousness of God with prayer. You cannot say you come to bind and loose and the devil is going to listen to you. No, live a righteous life. Because the devil does not listen to your vocabulary. Does not even listen to your voice. You think the louder we are, the more powerful we are. No. Righteousness. There are those people who have walked righteously. And scripture says, to those who overcome, I shall cause them to sit with me at the right hand of God the Father. It's only for overcomers. The people who have kept their road pure. And we must return the church to the ancient days of holiness. We must return the church there. Say, you must live a holy life. It is not a weakness. It's not a mistake. It's not my personality. No. One of us are called to live a holy life. You don't say, this is my personality. This this is how wicked as I am. Because nowadays, adultery is called affairs. You have having an affair. Imagine. It's like foreign affairs. It's not possible. Isaiah 61 verse 10 says, I will greatly rejoice with the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in God, for he has clothed me with garments of salvation. He has covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bride who decked himself with ornament, as a bride adorned herself with her jewels. Wow! He has adorned me. God has adorned me in righteousness. Righteousness is the robe that is given to us by God himself. Righteousness. About the holiness of your children, the righteousness, the spiritual legacy that you're leaving behind. I know you have a financial legacy. I know you have portfolios, investment that you're leaving your children. What about a spiritual legacy? Have you ever asked yourself, Job, the Bible says in the land of Uz, there was a man called Job, upright, eschewed people, and loved God. That guy was great and rich. But it came a time that Job always sacrificed on behalf of his children, saying, peradventure they have sinned and cast God in their hand. Look, that was a spiritual legacy he wanted to leave. See, are my children walking in righteousness? Are my children walking in holiness? Are they loving God? Are they, do they fear God? I know we are afraid for them to get pregnant. But are we also afraid for them to fear God? The same investment you make in them passing exams or going to a good school, you make the same investment as faith. My children shall be strong and know God. Hallelujah. Proverbs 11 verse 4 says, riches profit not in the day of wrath, but righteousness delivers from death. The righteousness of the perfect shall direct his way, but the wicked shall fall by his own wickedness. The righteousness of the upright shall deliver them, but transgression shall be taken in their own naughtiness. Righteousness will deliver you. It is interesting that righteousness delivers a man. Are you in a fix? Are you in a problem? Are you persecuted? Are people against you? Righteousness will deliver you. When you notice this, you realize there are very little binding and loosing we need to be doing. But our moments of prayer should be moments of worship and adoration. Because by living this kind of life, you're already winning. You're already fighting. Telling the truth. Living a righteous life, you're already winning. Have you been astonished by the prayers of Jesus? Jesus prayed very short prayers. Did you notice? In fact, in some places he did want to pray, like Lazarus. He says, Lord, I know you always hear what I say, isn't it? But for the sake of this religious people, please. He didn't want to pray because he knows the prayers. And scripture tells us that he went all night in prayer. And when the morning came, he went to the mountain. See, he had already met God. He had already lived a straight life. So in his asking, he knew God will always answer his prayers. It was not something he was trying. He was not trying to pray, no. He knew that God will answer all his prayers. And that is where God is calling us. Amen. Can we arise? Before you make a prayer, just respond to God's word. Lord, hold me to that righteousness, the truth. What's between in truth and in righteousness? In truth and in righteousness. Come on, raise your voice for a minute. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We thank you, Jehovah God, for putting on the full armor of God. Help us to live in the truth. We live a lie. Help us, Jehovah God, in the name of Jesus, to live a truthful, honest, transparent life to you. In the name of Jesus, our walk, our speech, our deeds shall be truthful. We shall live in the truth of your word. In the name of Jesus, help us to be cleansed, to be separated, to be set apart, consecrated for your use. In the name of Jesus, Father God, in Jesus' name, we thank you for your word. Thank you that you're equipping us this morning to live a victorious life. Help us to put on the armor of truth, that we shall live a truthful life. Our life shall embody Jesus, who is the way, the truth, and the life. Help us to be in right standing with you, to live a righteous life, a life that pleases you, in the name of Jesus. For only then shall our prayers have an impact and significance. In the name of the Lord, receive every glory and receive every praise. In Jesus' name.